I surrender all. Benji did an okay job on that, didn't he? Yeah. Yeah. You're hired, okay? 70,000 a year, okay? A month off, okay? Yeah, let's do this thing. All right, there's nobody up there.
Noah.
Oh, okay. No, is it? It's kind of early. No, I don't know why it's there.
Oh, you're taking. Does it matter?
My side.
Would you rather sit?
No, I don't care at all. What happened to your hair?
There's something wrong with it.
Yeah, man. Something happened.
it's like you dried it like, what was his name? Clay?
Roll the tape.
1, 2, 3. Testing. 1, 2, 3. Testing. 1, 2, 3. Test.
Test. Test.
Testing. 1.
Test. 3. Hey. Check.
Let's roll the same for that.
Yeah, let's do it.
He loves to hear the wind sing.
He loves to hear the wind sing as it whistles through the pines on mountain peaks. And he loves to hear the raindrops as they splash to the ground in a magic melody. And he smiles in sweet approval as the waves crash to the rocks in their harmony. All creation joins in unity to sing to him a majestic symphony. But his favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now may cling, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purchased by his blood lift to him a song of love, there's nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, that's his favorite song of all. He loves to hear the angels as they sing, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Heaven's choirs in harmony lift up praises to the great I Am.
Hallelujah.
But he lifts his hands for silence when the weak is saved by grace begin to see. And a million angels listen as a newborn soul sings, I have been redeemed. That's his favorite song of all, is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now may believe, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purchased by his love lift to him a song of love, there's nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, that his favorite song of all. It's not just melody and harmony to capture his attention. It's not just clever lines and phrases to cause him to stop and listen. But when any heart set free, watched him all by Calvary begins to see that's his favorite song of all. When lost sinners now may cleave, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purged by his blood, lift to him a song of love. There's nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, that's his favorite song of all. Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
What do I do though at the end of that phrase? Are we hitting a unison note there?
No, you hold up.
John Sullivan. Good to see you. Hi. How are you? Hi.
Ben Casey.
Hi. Good to see you. John Sullivan.
Marvin Miller.
Hey, Marvin. Good to see you. Hi, how you doing?
Bradley
White. Hey, Bradley. John Sullivan. Good to see you. Okay.
And we use the shoot for 11 o'clock.
Okay.
On 30-minute break after the shot goes down to 5-3.
That's good.
All right, let's head on.
That's good. I need, did you lock that door?
No, sir.
I need to get them in. I'll get it.
He's the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, the bright morning star. Let's stand as we sing All Hail King Jesus, and then All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. That's in number 202.
All Hail King Jesus, All Hail Emmanuel, King of Kings, Lord of Lords, bright morning star, and throughout eternity I'll sing his praises, and I'll reign with him throughout eternity.
Lift our voices, all hail the power.
All hail the power of Jesus' name. Let angels prostrate fall. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Bring forth the royal diadem and crown him Lord of all. Ye chosen seed of Israel's race, ye ransomed from the fold. Hail him who saves you by his grace and crown him Lord.
let's all lift our voices.
Let every kindred, every tribe on this terrestrial bowl, to him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all. To him all majesty ascribe and crown him Lord of all.
By an angry mob, the times that he was hung there on the cross to die in suffering and agony. No limitation to the power of that name. For he took that weakness, and he took that suffering, and he took that hurt, and he took that death, and he matched it with a resurrection. And that's what you and I have when we have the name of Jesus as Lord of our lives. For there is no weakness or trial or tribulation that you will face that intimidate Jesus, the one who called you to new worlds, like you've never been called before, to a place you never really wanted to go. He wasn't worried about what you would face here, because he knew he could handle it. He wasn't worried about what the professors would test you over. He knew he could handle it. He wasn't worried about what your family would face. For he knew he could handle it. Oh, we must always think of the power of Jesus, not only in terms of what it can accomplish, but of what cannot limit it. Not your weakness, not your hurt, not your trial can limit the power of Jesus. As we come before his presence, let's ask Perry Hancock, our Broadmoor Chair of Discipleship Professor, to please lead us in a word of prayer. Amen and amen. Before you sit down, remind somebody next to you there's power in the name of Jesus. Would you do that?
Hey, just reorder. By the way, there's power in the name of Jesus. Yeah, no. Dr. Kelly, that mic's not plugged in.
All right. Thank you so very much. As we welcome you to Level Chapel today for our time of worship and praise, we're delighted to have you with us. We remind you next week's going to be a wonderful week for Church of Brook Hills, a non-traditional church, very contemporary style. We'll be literally, the church will be here. We'll have their praise team, a bunch of lay people from that church, just their staff, their pastor Rick Owsley. We'll be doing our preaching. We'll have a wonderful time and experience what this kind of Southern Baptist church is like in our Lane lectures on church health. It's going to be a wonderful time of worship. And Thursday is tennis shoe day, when we're telling the faculty and everybody to dress casual, come in your tennis shoes, and we're going to enter into the type of church that the Church of Brook Hills is for next week. So we're going to have a great time together. But today we are so honored to have with us Dr. John Sullivan, Executive Director of the State of Florida Baptist Convention. Dr. Sullivan would be on anybody's short list of the people in Southern Baptist life who have done more for theological education than anybody else. For when Dr. Sullivan was pastor of Broadmoor Baptist Church in Shreveport, Louisiana, he made it possible for us to have an extension center in that church to teach people in that part of Louisiana who could not come to the main campus for their classes and prepare them for ministry. He not only made it possible, he taught a very full schedule there, week after week, semester after semester, every semester he was there at Broadmoor. He not only did that, he led his church to give us the Broadmoor Chair of Discipleship, an endowment that now reaches $1 million to endow the cost of a professor to help our students learn spiritual disciplines and spiritual habits. Right now, it is that professor who is coordinating our new spiritual mentoring program, whereby all of our new students are divided up into groups of about six or eight and walk with the faculty member for a year, meeting an hour a week, walking with God together, learning to live. That would not have happened had it not been for Dr. John Sullivan. And then God called him away from Broadmoor Baptist Church to the Florida Baptist Convention. And while he's been there, he has helped us start extension centers all over the state of Florida. He has encouraged us to work with the Florida Convention, with Florida Baptist Theological College and Seminary Extension, in making theological education more accessible to the people of Florida than it's ever been before. Dr. John Sullivan, we thank you for all you have done, not only in your tremendous pastoral ministry and preaching ministry, not only in your great leadership in our convention, but what you have personally done to make this seminary a healthy seminary and to help us stay focused on the right things, building healthy churches. Thank you for all that you have done. He's a pretty fired up preacher, so I'm just warning you. Get ready to listen fast. Get ready to have your Bibles out and take notes. He's a wonderful expositor of the Word of God. He has a great message that God has laid on his heart just for us today. We're going to enter now into another time of worship, and then after that, Dr. John Sullivan.
Take your worship bulletin. We're going to continue to worship by singing Change My Heart, O God, and then hymn number 275. Most of you won't even need your hymnal for this. I Surrender All. Let's stand as we sing Change My Heart.
Change my heart, O God. Make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you. You are the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
You are the potter.
You are the potter, I am the clay. Hold me and make me, this is what I pray. Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like you.
The whistles through the pines on mountain peaks. And he loves to hear the raindrops as they splash to the ground in a magic melody. And he smiles in sweet approval as the waves crash through the rocks in their harmony. All creation joins in unity to sing to hear majestic symphony. But his favorite song of all is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now may flee, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purchased by his blood
lift to him a song of love. There's nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, than his favorite song of all.
He loves to hear the angels as they sing, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
Heaven's choirs in harmony lift up praises to the great High.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
But he lifts his hands for silence when the weak is saved by grace begin to see. And a million angels listen as a newborn soul sings, I have been redeemed.
That's his favorite song of all, is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now may glean, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purchased by his blood, nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, that's his favorite song of all. It's not just melodies and harmonies that capture his attention. It's not just clever lines and phrases that causes him to stop and listen. But when any heart set free, watched and mobbed by Calvary, begins to see. Song of all is the song of the redeemed. When lost sinners now may glean, lift their voices loud and strong. When those purchased by his blood, lift to him a song of love. Nothing more he'd rather hear, nor so pleasing to his ear, that's his favorite song of all. Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Holy, holy, holy is the Lamb.
That was a wonderful introduction by Dr. Kelly, but you don't have to applaud just because I'm getting ready to preach. Thank you, Dr. Kelly, for those kind words. It's a joy for me to be here and to share in the life of this seminary that I came to love over the 14 years I pastored the Broadmoor Baptist Church in Shreveport. God blessed our relationship in many ways. So it's a joy. You've heard about the fellow who wife was on her deathbed, and he went in to see her for one last time. She said, now I have one last request. I want you and my mother to ride together in the hearse. Said, I know you have been at odds all the years we've been married. You have never gotten along one minute, but I want you to do this as my last request. You and mother ride together in the hearse. He said, okay. But it'll take all the joy out of the ride. Now, some of you will get that about 3 o'clock. It'll come through. It'll filter. Turn in Scripture with me, please, to Revelation chapter 5. Revelation chapter 5. I want to talk to you today about the worthiness of Jesus Christ for your life. Jesus is worthy of your life. Revelation chapter 5. Revelation 5 is that story, that wonderful story of the identification of Jesus as the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. As John comes to write it, you remember in Revelation chapter 1, it is Christ alone. You find the best description of Jesus Christ using Old Testament analogy in Revelation 1 that you will find in Scripture. Revelation chapter 2 and 3 is Christ and the churches, where He writes those magnificent letters to the churches of Asia Minor that still for us have message and meaning. And then beginning with about chapter 4, He starts writing about Christ and the conflict. And then about the middle of chapter 19, it's Christ and the conquest. But here in the middle of all of this, there is this injunction of Jesus as the Lamb of God. Listen, please, for this now is the Word of God. And I saw in the right hand of Him that sat upon the throne a book written within and on the backside, sealed with seven seals. And I saw a strong angel proclaiming with a loud voice, "Who is worthy to open the book and to loose the seals thereof?" And no man in heaven nor in earth, neither under the earth, was able to open the book, neither to look thereon. And I wept much because no man was found worthy to open and to read the book, neither to look thereon. And one of the elders said unto me, "Weep not. Behold, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, hath prevailed to open the book and to loose the seven seals thereof." And I beheld, and lo, in the midst of the throne and of the four beasts, in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb as it had been slain, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the spirits of God, sent forth into all of the earth. And He came and took the book out of the right hand of Him that sat upon the throne. And when He had taken the book, the four beasts and the 24 elders fell down before the Lamb, having every one of them harps and golden vials full of odors, which are the prayers of the saints. And they sang a new song, saying, "Thou art worthy to take the book and to open the seals thereof, for Thou wast slain and hast redeemed us to God by Thy blood out of every kindred and tongue and people and nation, and has made us unto our God kings and priests, and we shall reign on the earth." And I beheld and heard the voice of many angels round about the throne and the beast and the elders, and the number of them was 10,000 times 10,000 and thousands of thousands, saying with a loud voice, "Worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessing. And every creature which is in heaven and on the earth and under the earth, and such as are in the sea, and all that are in them, heard I say, blessing and honor and glory and power be unto Him that sitteth upon the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever." And the four beasts said, "Amen." And the 24 elders fell down and worshipped Him that lives forever and forever. It would be no secret to you that all of the Gospels began at a different place. For instance, when you come to talk about Matthew's Gospel, he begins with Abraham, tracing the lineage through Abraham. Mark begins with the prophets. If Mark were alive and writing today, he would write in the vein of Louis L'Amour. Everything is always on the move with Mark. Nothing settles down for very long. It's quick. It's fast. When you come to Luke, he starts with Adam, goes all the way back, tracing the lineage of Jesus back to Adam. And then when you come to John, he goes back to eternity. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory," and His glory matched the glory of God. But another interesting thing about the four Gospels is that they are all entwined with this man, John the Baptist, and the announcing of Jesus as the Messiah. They ask John, "Are you the Messiah? Are you the one who is to come? Are you the deliverer? Are you the one we have waited for all of this time?" And finally, John, confessing, "I am not the Messiah," and pointed to Jesus and said, but He is. He is the Messiah. He is the Lamb of God. He is the one taking away the sin of the world. I want you to see three things in this passage today. First, I want you to see the hesitation of John, as suddenly he realizes that here is the seven-sealed book of destiny, the hesitation. Once there is the hesitation, then the identification. Who is this Lamb of God that John's talking about? What is this announcement that he's making? And once you move beyond the identification, there is the celebration that comes from the angels and the elders and all that are in the earth and beneath the earth, all that are in heaven, celebrate this Lamb of God because of His worthiness. Jesus Christ is worthy of your life. Jesus Christ is worthy of your life. If you haven't pinned that down, you are going to spend your life on someone or something. I am here to tell you, Jesus is worthy of your life. Knowing that you're going to spend it in the right place. Spend it in Jesus Christ. Spend it serving Him. He is worthy of your life. The hesitation. John receives the book, and then he starts looking for someone to open the book. I am convinced that this is the book of destiny. And in opening the book of destiny, it will be revealed. Those things that are going to come, those names that are in the Lamb's Book of Life, and all of that scenario that happens in destiny. Now, I hope you understand that you are not here today because of your luck. You are not a product of luck. You are a product of the providence of God. Your destiny is God's destiny. Your destiny is His destiny. And as a result of that, we come to understand that in this book of destiny, John looks for someone to open it and to reveal what's in the book. And he looks and there is no one on the earth. I would remind you there was a good crop of second generation believers who had been through some difficult times. They had given their lives and they had watched others give their lives for the cause of Christ. But there was none of them worthy to open the book. John said, I looked upon the earth and there was no one. I looked beneath the earth and there was no one. I looked into heaven and there was no one, John said. No one in heaven to open the book. By this time there was a right good crowd congregated in heaven, that great cloud of witness that surrounds us and encourages on in the faith that he writes about in the book of Hebrews. But no one in heaven. Moses was in heaven by this time, and Moses could open up the Red Sea, but he couldn't open up the book of destiny. He could open up the ground and let the rebellious sons of Korah fall into the ground, but he couldn't open the book of destiny. Elijah could stand on the top of Mount Carmel and see the skies open and the fire fall and consume the sacrifice in the presence of the prophets of Baal, but he could not open this book. Simon Peter could pray and the jail's house doors would open and he would be set free. He could open the doors of the prison, but he couldn't open this book. Couldn't open this book. Paul and Silas could sing at midnight and turn that jailhouse into a concert hall. And they could open up all of the vistas of freedom, but they couldn't open this book. And John realized, there was no one on the earth. There was no one in heaven. There was no one beneath the earth that could open the book. And John said, when I understood that, I started to cry. Those that have written well about this text say that this interpretation is stop crying. And this is the strongest kind of crying possible in the human experience. I liken it. It's the kind of crying you do when you catch your thumb in a car door. You don't make up your mind you're going to cry. You just cry. It's the kind of crying you do when you hit your thumb with a hammer. You don't contemplate, now, does this hurt and am I going to cry? Because you just cry.
It's the kind of crying that the prodigal father must have done when he looked down the road every day to see if his son was coming home. And I can see that father, anyone who has had a child that has been wayward for any period of time, knows the heartache and the heartbreak and the tears that come as a result. This is the kind of crying that a father does for a prodigal child. You don't make up your mind, am I going to cry over my son? Am I going to cry over my daughter? No, you don't make up your mind, you just cry. And when John realized that there was no one worthy to open the book, he started to cry. And then the word came, stop crying. And he said, I turned and looked, and behold, I was introduced to the Lamb of God. Introduced to the Lamb of God. I wondered why the introduction to the Lamb of God. Why didn't John just turn and say, I saw Jesus? Why didn't he turn and say, I saw the Messiah? Because that's the identification that I want to come through crystal clear as we talk about the identification of this Lamb of God. The identification of the Lamb of God is significant. The Lamb of God is the integrating theme of all of the Bible. It is the integrating theme of all of the Bible. When I got onto this idea, this identification of the Lamb of God, I started reading everything I could lay my hands on to document what I believed in my heart. And then suddenly I realized it's so. It is the integrating theme. It is that thread that runs through from Genesis to Revelation. One writer said you can go back to Genesis chapter 4 to pick up the thread of the Lamb of God. I'm not sure you can go back to chapter 4 of the book of Revelation, the book of Genesis, without some kind of speculation. That's the story of Cain and Abel. One writer said it was because Abel's sacrifice was a blood sacrifice and Cain's was an agricultural sacrifice that it was accepted by God. That's not what Scripture says. It just says it was a more worthy sacrifice. Now, theologically, I believe that's true. But I can't go to the Word of God and say to you that the Lamb of God, as the integrating theme of the Bible, starts as Genesis chapter 4. But I can say, with authority, without equivocation, I can say, when you come to Genesis chapter 22, there is no question about the Lamb of God. That's the story of Abraham and Isaac. You remember Abraham and Isaac? Abraham, late in his years, the son of promise came, loved that boy with all the love that a father could have for a child, and probably then some, because he was the son of promise. He had waited so long on Isaac, had made so many mistakes while he was waiting on Isaac, and finally, here was the son of promise, and God finally put the most severe test that any father could ever have when he said to Abraham, now I want you to take your son, your only son, I want you to take him to the mountain, and I want you to make a sacrifice of your son on the mountain. I need to know, Abraham, do you love me more than you love Isaac? This is the litmus test. This is the acid test. I need to know whether you love me more than you love the boy. And Abraham got his son ready. They made that awful trek. Every question the boy asked must have been like an ice pick in his father's heart. And finally they got to the place. And Isaac looked at his father and said, Father, we brought the wood. Father, we brought the fire. But we forgot the lamb. Do you remember Abraham's response? Abraham said, Jehovah Jireh, God will provide the lamb. God will provide. Got his son ready, laid him on the altar for sacrifice. And the word came that through God saying to Abraham, no, this is not it. And he turned and he looked, and there was a ram caught in the thicket as God had made the provision of the lamb. I am here to tell you that Jesus Christ is God's provision of the lamb of sacrifice. All of the system of the Old Testament predicates on the fact that there's going to come one who will make a rational, volitional, permanent decision to be the Lamb of God. And Jesus is the one. Oh, but you come across to the book of Exodus. Not only is it God's provision in the book of Exodus, the story of the Exodus coming out of the land of bondage to the land of promise, coming out of Egypt into the place that God had promised. And as they came out, Pharaoh was reluctant. His heart began to harden. And every time a new plague would come, the heart would become harder until finally there was the last plague. And it was the plague of death for the firstborn. God said, here's what I want you to do. I want you to kill the lamb and put the blood of the lamb on the post and the lintel of the door. And when the angel of death sees the blood, he will pass over you. Do you realize that when you stand in a door frame, that you are covered by the door frame? You are surrounded by the door frame? Across the post and the lintel of the door, as I am covered by the blood of the Lamb. It is God's provision. It is also God's slaying of the Lamb that we need to accustom ourselves to. And then the book of Leviticus tells us the character of that Lamb. It is to be a Lamb without spot. It is to be a Lamb without blemish. It is to be the best of the best. Someone prayed it earlier. It's not better, it's the best. Jesus is the very best lamb that God could find. He is the very best that God could give to mankind. He is the very best. Everything in me cries out, Jesus is the best I could know. In His ethics, He's the best I could know. In His walk, He's the best I could know. In His thinking, He's the best I could know. In His death, He is the best I can know. There is none better than Jesus Christ. He is the best lamb that God has for us. He is the best. He has the character. It matches the glory of God. We beheld His glory. His glory was God's glory. He is not only the provision of God, the slaying of the Lamb, the character of the Lamb. You come to Isaiah. I wish I had time to trace it all the way through, but you come to Isaiah and suddenly you realize He's no longer talking about an animal. He's no longer talking about one of those little four-footed furry creatures. He's talking about a man that's going to be the Lamb of Sorrows. He's talking about one who is going to come and by His stripes we will be healed. He's talking about a person. And then you come to the New Testament, to John chapter 1, verse 29. Who is this person that Isaiah prophesies about? Who is this one that is going to come? Why, it's Jesus, John the Baptist says, as He comes to be baptized in the River Jordan. Now we not only know that it's a man, we know which man it is. It's Jesus, the one from Nazareth, who is the Lamb of God. He's the Lamb of God. He's the Lamb of God. Oh, and then you come to the book of Revelation chapter 22, and there's the great picture of the throne in heaven. Guess who's on the throne? Why, the Lamb is upon the throne. From Genesis to Revelation, it is the thread that ties all the integrating theme of redemption in Jesus Christ. When I got onto this idea, I wondered, this name of Jesus, how much difficulty Jesus must have had in identifying Himself to people. How much of difficulty He must have had just letting it be known who He was. I wonder what really happened at the temple. We don't have all of the story. We know they left Him, came back to get Him. Do you suppose, that Jesus entered into dialogue with those elders in the temple? Their conversation might have gone something like this as Jesus tried to identify Himself. One of the elders said, son, what's your name? Jesus said, well, on my mother's side, my name is Jesus. But on my father's side, my name is Emmanuel. My name is the lily of the valley. My name is the I am on my father's side. Well, son, how old are you? Well, on my mother's side, I am 12. But on my father's side, I am without beginning and I am without end. Well, son, where do you live? Well, on my mother's side, I live in Nazareth. But on my father's side, my home is glory. Well, son, do you have other brothers and sisters? Oh, yes, there is James and there is Jude and there are the others. On my mother's side, I have James and Jude and the others. But on my father's side, I am the only begotten son full of grace and full of truth. Well, son, what kind of work do you do? Well, on my mother's side, I am an apprentice carpenter in the carpenter shop of Joseph in Nazareth. But on my father's side, my work is redemption. Well, son, what's your father's name? Who are your parents? Well, on my mother's side, my parents are Mary and Joseph, the ones from Nazareth. But on my father's side, his name is Jehovah, the living God who comes down to touch our lives. Oh. The identification of the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. But then there is the celebration. The celebration when all heaven breaks loose. And they start singing. The angels start singing. Everybody gets involved in the celebration. I preached at a conference recently, preached this sermon. And they were having the emphasis on Celebrate Jesus 2000. We don't celebrate Jesus very well. We don't celebrate Him in our life very well. Because somehow we imagine that we had something to do with it. We imagine that somehow we had something that put it together in our lives. Let me tell you, I said it earlier, let me repeat it again. I'm not a product of luck. I am a product of the grace of God and the providence of God. I listened to a preacher preach recently on Rahab the harlot. And he made an astute observation when he said, Rahab went from the house of shame to the hall of fame. That's what happened to me. That's what happened in my life. I'm here to tell you that's what happened to me. I went from shame to fame. I went from nothing to somebody. For the first time in my life, when Jesus came into my life, I realized I'm somebody. And I'm that somebody that God has given something to do and no one else can do it but me. And I'm willing to do it, Lord, if you'll just point me in the right direction. I am here to tell you that I am not a product of circumstance. I am not a product of happenstance. I am not a product of someone's error. I am a product of the providence of God as He sent His Son to save me, to redeem me out of my lostness as the Lamb of God. If I can't celebrate that, I've got a problem. If I cannot celebrate Jesus in my life, I have a problem. There's a lot of discussion going on right now about what is praise. Let me tell you, praise is not what you do. Praise is who you are. When we understand that, oh, if you can't praise Him in the marketplace, don't praise Him in the showcase. If you're not going to praise Him on the job, don't praise Him in the church. Oh, if I can't get excited, I'm going to leave that alone. But if I can't get excited and celebrate Jesus Christ alive in my life, I have a problem. Glory and power and honor and blessing. Blessing and honor and glory and power. That blessing of God to my life. Do you know that in your life, because you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, there is absolutely nothing, as the President mentioned earlier, there is absolutely nothing that Jesus cannot do for you? Go back to the 23rd Psalm. The 23rd Psalm is not a psalm of death. It is a psalm of relationship of the shepherd to the sheep. And if I am hungry, the sheep says, if I am hungry, He takes me to the green pastures. If I am thirsty, He takes me to the still water. If I am frazzled, if I'm on my last lap, if I'm wondering, oh God, will this ever end? I am under the pressure. I am under the gun. God, it seems like that every day life tumbles in. What then? Oh, if I cannot understand that in the moment of my life, when I am at the end of my tether, He restores my soul. And then He walks with me through the valley of the shadow of death in those dark moments of my life when there is apprehension and there is caution. He walks me through the valley, and His rod of protection and staff of correction, they comfort me. If that's not enough, when I come out, if I am intimidated by my enemies, He prepares a table before me right in the presence of my enemies. He anoints my head with oil. My cup runs over. Goodness and mercy trot after me all of the days of my life. There is nothing God cannot do in Jesus Christ for you in this life. But that doesn't end it. I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The blessings of Jesus Christ. The glory of Jesus Christ. The glory of Jesus Christ. Oh, every knee shall bow. Every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. Blessing, honor, power. The power of Jesus Christ. I've shared this probably in this chapel, but it is so much a part of me every time I talk about the power of Jesus Christ. In 1967, I went through the most tumultuous point of my ministry. Had nothing to do with my salvation, had nothing to do with my call. It had to do with my vocation within the call. I was so confused. I didn't know where I was going to turn. I didn't know what God wanted me to do. I felt in my own heart, God, if you'll let me know, I'm willing to do it. If you want me to be a missionary, I really believed I would be a missionary. If you want me to teach, I'll be glad to teach. If you want me to do whatever, God, you want for my life, I am willing to do. And that was one of those times I couldn't get an answer. Just seemed like God wasn't answering. There was nothing wrong in my relationship. God just wasn't letting me know. And I went to the evangelism conference in Dallas, Texas. And I heard for the first time S.M. Lockridge, the pastor of the great Calvary Baptist Church in San Diego, California, who recently went on to be with the Lord. I was searching. I was looking. And in that sermon on the Lordship of Christ, Lockridge started the sermon by saying the hinges of human history swing on the insignificant man who has linked his life to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. I didn't know all he meant, but I knew that's what I wanted. I didn't know all he had in mind, but I knew that's what I wanted. I listened so intently to what he was saying, and it was the turning point in my life. Something happened to me that night. Something happened to me that is inexplicable in my own experience. I left that place with the confidence of what God wanted me to do and how God wanted me to respond to what I heard about the Lordship of Jesus Christ. But right in the middle of that sermon, as only Lockridge was given to, he started talking about the power of Jesus Christ. And he asked the question, if you decided to destroy the power of Jesus Christ, what would you use for power to destroy His power? Now, that's a legitimate question. That's precisely what the president was talking about just before we started the chapel service. If you decided that you were going to destroy the power of Jesus Christ, what would you use for power to destroy His power? Don't you know that if you try to use fire, He'll refuse to burn? Do you remember the story of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they heated up the fiery furnace. They put Him in the fiery furnace. They went down to find those cinders and ashes the next day. They didn't see three in the fiery furnace. They saw four in the fiery furnace as Jesus became the thermostat in the fire. Oh, what are you going to use for power to destroy His power? If you try to use fire, He'll refuse to burn. If you try to use a mighty wind, He'll stand up in the boat and say to the wind, peace be still, and it will lie down at His feet and lick His hand. What would you use for power to destroy His power? If you try to use water, He'll walk on the water. What would you use for power to destroy His power? If you try to use death, He'll clean out the grave and make it a decent place to wait for the resurrection. Listen to Jesus, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Now you take the same power and go out into the world and tell others that Jesus Christ is alive. He is the Lamb of God that takes away the sin of the world. And no matter what else I do in my ministry, the bottom line of my ministry is life and death. Life and death. With the Lamb of God there is life, and without the Lamb of God there is death. My friend, I want you to know Jesus is worthy of your life.
Courage.